Some of you will have heard of three-layer architectures such as Model View Controller, Model View Presenter, or Model View View Model. Whether or not these are new terms to you, I am going to teach you about the fundamental separations of code that give rise to these patterns. The truth is that it is not so important that you follow any specific pattern. No pattern works great in every situation. What is more important is to follow the principle of separation of concerns. Doing so will help you understand and apply concepts from each of these common patterns, but it will also help you understand when it is appropriate not to follow a pattern. In fact, if you study and practice software architecture long enough, it will become clear to you that complex applications simply cannot be divided into just three layers. Some of the things I say in this lesson will seem a bit too restrictive, tedious, or like they just create extra work. What you have to understand is that the consequences of not following these rules will scale with the size and complexity of the program you are writing. This is all practice for the big show, and if you really do not believe me, I encourage you to build a medium-sized application that does not apply separation of concerns. When I started out as a programmer, I had almost no direction, and I did exactly that. Those painful memories and experiences of having to rebuild an entire application just to add one new feature will always stay with me. Just to clarify, the term layer in software architecture has to do with what a given class is concerned with. Every three-layer architecture you have seen represents a fundamental separation of three kinds of code. Code which manages the user interface, or view classes. Code which provides structured storage and access to data, or model classes. Code which coordinates the other two layers in a logical fashion, which I like to call logic classes. Now, I will break these layers down even further, but these three distinctions are a good general way to think about your code. The main styles, such as MVC, MVP, and MVVM, to a lesser degree, are in a broad sense always a breakdown of these three layers. I'm often asked which one is best, but the truth is that for every style, what makes it good in certain situations makes it bad in other situations. To make this even more confusing, people do not even build them the same way. I have written about these situations in various articles, but like I said, in this lesson we will focus on the reasoning process rather than the specific styles or patterns. If you are building something with a graphical user interface, your app will need to interact with tools such as JavaFX or Swing for Java Desktop, Java EE for web apps, or the Android SDK for mobile. There is an important term to describe a kind of class which must necessarily deal with some kind of external driver or library, such as the UI, a database, or some kind of system service. We say that this class is tightly coupled to whichever driver or library. An easy way to know what a class is coupled to is to check the import statements it possesses. In the demo Sudoku app, my user interface impl is tightly coupled to JavaFX. Although a Sudoku game looks visually very simple, we have 81 different text field objects to draw, listen to for inputs, and update appropriately. These problems all have to do with interacting with a user interface, and therefore it makes sense to separate these problems from others, such as generating a new Sudoku puzzle, or checking if the current one is complete. The standard name for this kind of user interface class is a view, and thus it conceptually fits into the view layer of a typical architecture style. One of the biggest difficulties with view classes is a direct result of their tight coupling. They are difficult to test. Unless you use some tools which mock or create a fake version of their libraries or frameworks, the only way to test them is to actually build and deploy an application. One final note before we move on. This application has one screen, so I have included the style information inside of this view class. However, in an application with multiple screens, I would follow the dry principle and pull any style information into a separate data structure that can be shared globally. I have already defined what model means extensively in part 2 of this application. Recall that this word in general describes anything to do with structured storage and access to data. However, when speaking of software architecture, there is some confusion about this word, which I will discuss. In a historical context, this word model, as defined in the original model view controller pattern, did not refer to a class which implemented long-term storage. People still argue about these definitions to this day, but I think it is better to understand each definition rather than wasting time arguing over which one is correct or incorrect. I like to categorize data, or state, in an application in two ways. First, we have user session state. This kind of data lives only as long as the program or some particular screen of the program is running. To give you a clear example, if I remove the long-term storage from my Sudoku app, the user can still complete puzzles as long as they keep the app running. The time during which a user is actually using the app can be thought of as a session. The other kind of state has the potential to persist longer than runtime. The Sudoku app actually stores the state of the Sudoku puzzle so that the user can close the app and continue the same puzzle later. Anyways, the reason I bring this distinction up is that these different kinds of states and the parts of the model which implement them need to be treated differently. Persistence mechanisms, such as databases, network adapters, file storage, etc., should be hidden behind an interface. What I just told you in technical terms is to employ the repository pattern, which is more generally known as the facade pattern. Design patterns is a topic too big to go into detail with here, but understand that similar problems are often best solved with similar patterns. Doing this will effectively allow you to hide the details of your persistence mechanisms from the rest of your application. To be clear, what I am saying is that if you do not use interfaces anywhere else, I really recommend you use them as a bridge between what we can think of as the front end of your application versus the back end. In fact, the front end should have no idea whether the data it receives and inputs is coming from a file, a database, or a cloud server. Remember, all we are doing here is applying separation of concerns. Finally, we come to logic. Again, some good news. I have already explained to you the different types of logic. We can think of control logic as a controller or presenter or honestly even a view model depending on how you use it. It handles events and it coordinates between the other layers or classes. In this Sudoku app, I have a class which is literally called control logic. As you can see, it holds references to the view and the storage by interface. This makes it easier to test as I do not need to deploy the application and have a real view or real persistence mechanisms behind these interfaces. Another subset of control logic, which I suggest you keep separate from other things, is what I like to call build logic. This relates to the term dependency injection, if you have ever heard of it. Martin Fowler, my favorite authority on software architecture, summed this up beautifully by discussing the principle of separating configuration from use. As for computation logic, we are of course talking about classes or methods which validate user input, solve equations, or build Sudoku puzzles. At first, I just had one single class which was supposed to encapsulate all of the computation logic necessary for my Sudoku game to function properly. It turned out that this was actually a pretty complicated process, so I ended up creating two more classes to separate things even further. The game generator class generates a completed valid Sudoku game. Now, since a completed Sudoku game is not really fun to solve in any sense of the word, I needed to unsolve the game. It turned out once again that this process was kind of complicated. At first, I thought I would just remove 40 numbers, but it turns out that you cannot just do that and expect your puzzle to be solvable. So after I removed the 40 characters, I fed the resulting grid into a class called Sudoku Solver, which would tell me if it was solvable. Anyways, why I am telling you this is to share my thought process. The more I learned about the problem of generating a new Sudoku game and validating an existing one, the more it made sense to further divide this logic up into distinct classes. Admittedly, some of these methods are still pretty huge, but this is a result of working with algorithms that require a large number of steps. At the very least, you will notice that I have written all kinds of comments to remind myself what each method does in detail. I am a big fan of clean architecture, I have studied solid principles for years, I have tested out all major architectures, and I have even seen how inadequate three-layer architectures tend to be outside of very simple scenarios. While I hope I have done a decent job of sharing some of that knowledge, the truth is that you will never understand these things clearly if you do not apply them by building applications. Do not be afraid to try different things, and while having preferences is okay, do not become dogmatic about any particular architecture.